So basically, we will start. My topic is like Android and iOS lab setup. So we would like to start this. First, we will like to know about how to set up a lab. This is like the basic thing. If you want to do vulnerability assessment, you need to set up a lab. So about me first, I'm Danish Inamdar, working as security VAPT at CDAC Hyderabad. So for starting with the Android labs and like doing vulnerability assessment and penetration testing, you need to have understanding of the mobile Android application architecture. You need to be hands-on with the tool called Bob Suit. So Bob Suit is basically a tool used for interception of the backend request response. You can like check. And then you should be hands-on with the Linux operating system and the commands. And this is the system requirements, and you need to have a virtual machine set up and all for this. Further, we are moving ahead. Things we need to start for Android vulnerability assessment, that is, you need an APK file, Android package file, that is needed. So after that, you need the registration rules and information and kind of all. And for installing that APK on APK, you need a virtual device, or you can use a real device. Even you can use a rooted device. That helps to like a rooted device basically provides much more access than a normal phone. And you need virtual machines like Tamr, Santoku, or Appi on Windows. Appi is basically a like software that you can install on Windows to start with the testing lab setup and set up all your tools. If you don't want to install an Appi on Windows, then you can go for a virtual machine like Tamr or Santoku or Mobile Xchair. Fine. Next. So basically, Android apps have current version is like 10. These are the Oreo, Pi, and that all are there. So Android application basically written in C++, Java, and Kotlin. And these are the basic frameworks like Ionic, PhoneGap, and Cordova. So we move ahead with the architecture. In this architecture, we see that there is a basic. It's based on the Linux kernel. Then there are in the Linux kernel you have the drivers. Above that you have the Android runtime and the Dalvik virtual machine, and that helps to run the DEX code. There is a DEX code. So for running that you need this, and above that there is a libraries. These libraries are help for interaction with the hardware and all. So above that there is a framework, application framework. There is the activity managers, like telephony manager is for communicating with the contacts. Location is for GPS and all, content providers and all. It helps provides database. And above that is there is a applications, home, contacts, whatever, WhatsApp and all, whatever applications, that is the application layer. That is visible to us. Below that, all this is the backend that is not normally visible to us. So like when you want to analyze an APK file, you need to decode or decompile that file. After decoding or decompiling the APK, you get the following details. That is the manifest Android file, XML file. So in the manifest file, these are the permissions that we can check, all the component details we can check. And also after decompiling APK, we get the library, assets, classes, Smalley, and all this kind of code. I will show you a demo of this later. So the Android application components, what are the Android application components? For Android application to work, or it interacts with different components within it. That are basically the activity, that is the user interface or GUI visible to us. Beyond that, is there are services that are running in background and foreground, so that runs at the backend. And services communicate with the broadcast receivers and content providers. So like these are the things that are there in the backend. So for a developer, this code looks like this. When he is developing, this is where the code looks. As a user, we are not having this kind of things to see, but as a developer, he can see. Even an attacker who decompiles this, similarly they can see this kind of code. So demo. I will show you a demo. Okay, so my screen is visible. You can comment in the chat box. Is that video properly visible? Hello. Okay, I will reshare. I will try to share again. I have prepared a demo session. Like what I am doing is here, I have taken a demo APK, Android APK package file. So I have installed this on I have taken this done this demo on a Windows machine. So Windows machine, I have installed API, and using ls we check the file listed files. So in this folder we have an Android.apk file which we can use for assessment and checking how the assessment is done, vulnerability assessment. Yeah, so using the file command we will be checking the file type of the APK. So see, APK is basically a zip archived file. So to know how what the contents are there in this APK file that is in zip format, we use a tool called APK tool. So we will be doing this APK tool D compile. D is for the decompile, decompiling the APK. So we will write the name of the demo file, that is androgo.apk. Dash O is for the output. The output will be stored in a folder called test. See, so it is like decompiling. So basically, this is like a reverse engineering. So we need to analyze the APK. So like in previous session, sir was telling, sir Sunil sir had informed that the APK is malicious or not. So how we check? This is the way we check the files is malicious or what kind of data it holds. So what is the type of data it is transferring to others? So now we can check in the CD test. We are changing the directory to test. And now we see that the contents inside of the decompiled folder of APK. So first we will go ahead and check the manifest file. Cat command to display the contents of the manifest file. See, the manifest file is the XML format file that is visible. So basically, when you are analyzing APK, you analyze the complete files and folders. So this first file that we are checking is the manifest file. Fine. So see, like what kind of permission it is checking. So we can check this using the user. Sometimes what happens when we are using the application, we don't get pop-up for some permissions. So that permissions you can check over here in the manifest file. Yeah, these are the permissions like internet and all, write, external, read. These are the permissions that are given. And beyond that, we can check for the application. Like some weaknesses are there or vulnerability that can be lead to an attack or exploit. Like application has allowed, you can see has allowed debuggable set to true. So production ready or a application that is working should not have debug enabled in this. So if it is enabled, our attacker can get access to the code of the application. As the application is running in debug mode, he can debug and understand the code and all. So that like some GWR plugin can be used and debug, and you can understand how the application is working, and it is like big vulnerability. And similarly, network configuration. Some application try to communicate over insecure network, so that kind of communication should not be there. So all these kind of checks you need to do. Other than that, the components like activity is there here. That all needs to be checked. This is like the basic checks we need to do while doing testing on that. Yeah, we move ahead and move to the next. So for the M1, what is this M1? Basically, for whenever we do vulnerability assessment, there is an organization called OWASP. So OWASP defines the top 10 vulnerabilities. Like in the web application, there is a top 10 list of vulnerabilities. Similarly, in mobile application also, the OWASP has defined top 10 vulnerabilities. So I will be discussing them. First one is the improper platform usage. So what happens is sometimes like platform misuse happens of the platform. Like there is a security feature enabled that is not properly used by application. So some bypass happens like Touch ID, that all kind of bypass can happen. So yeah, move next. Like how to fix or mitigate this in your application. So like by default, whenever application is storing data, it should store sensitive data in an internal file system called Android Keychain. That is secure way of storing data in Android applications. Further, you should avoid misuse of activities services by setting it to false. You should not export from if unnecessary, if it is not required, you should not export activities or services. You should set it to false. Further, use of explicit intent for communications. This should be avoided, and you can set these permissions for your files that are there in your Android application to avoid like any kind of attack. We move ahead. Further, next is insecure local storage. So what is insecure local storage? Like whenever you install an application or log in into an application in mobile application, after logging into the application, it stores your data, like whatever data you have entered during sign up, it will be stored. So we need to ensure that data stored inside a mobile application by the in the device, it is in a secure format. So for analyzing this, you need to have a root access. A normal phone, we cannot check how the data is stored. For that, you need to have a rooted device. So rooting a device is not an easy procedure. For that, you need to know how rooting procedure, and that is a part of the vulnerability assessment or testing. It's not for a normal user. So, like after when you install application on a rooted device, then we can check how it is storing data. If it is in clear text, then it is not a proper thing that can be reported as a vulnerability. And further, sometimes what happens, like some banking applications are there. So that banking application, like when you type the password, that gets stored in the logs. That log files, it is getting stored, it is a vulnerability. As anyone can access log files, like other application installed can get access to the log files of the device. So it is this kind of checks should be there in the mobile application. That should avoid storing information in logs. Yeah, so mitigation, like what care could be taken that your data is secure in your local storage of mobile. That is shared preferences folder is there inside a local storage. So you should set the permissions at not world readable mode. So any other application other than the normal ones will not able to read the contents of your other application. Like your banking app details will not be available to other WhatsApp or Facebook apps. So this kind of checks you need to implement. Further, stored data, whatever data it is being stored, it needs to be encrypted, or encryption should be set using the technique called SQL cipher. This can be used. Further, using set storage to encryptions, this kind of permissions you can use. And even for a developer, we recommend using JavaX crypto library. And also, as I mentioned, that logs should be disabled in the application. That is need to be done. And further, insecure communication. So what happens is, it is recommended that you use HTTPS for website as well as mobile application. But some malicious application tend to use what you call HTTP. So that should be avoided. So that is the case. Yeah, fine. We can move ahead. So how to mitigate? Like we should make use of digital certificates. to avoid interception. Like your data, when you're transferring over internet, it is not that if you implement HTTPS, no one can intercept your data. It is possible to intercept if you have not enabled SSL pinning. So as a kind of protection, you need to enable SSL pinning on your mobile application that is being developed. And further, this kind of certificates you need to avoid that are being used. So this is the thing you need to implement. Yeah, insufficient cryptography. So what is insufficient cryptography? Cryptography is basically like whatever data is being stored, it is encrypted using some algorithms. So algorithms that are being used should be secure ones. It should not be outdated. So like whatever key storage for whatever store like information you are using, that should be secure. So you need to have proper algorithms in place. Next, insecure authentication. Like what happens is sometimes we log in into application like using username and password. And what happens is it validates at server end. If the application username and password is correct, then only we will get logged into the application. But sometimes what happens, that is the normal procedure. But when you enter this details, this should go to the server to validate if the application is and means the user has entered correct details or not. But what happens, sometimes it does not goes to the server to check the details are correct or not. It will check at the client end, means in the device, means in the code only the store the username and password. So anyone who gets access to the codes, slides are okay, anyone that get access to the codes can get the hard-coded information. So avoid storing hard-coded information in application. It is from a developer perspective. So for even we should have proper account lockout feature and other things in the OTP two-factor authentication that are important when you are implementing login based applications. Okay, first mitigation for this, like I told, multi-factor authentication, you need to have password or MPIN or OTP set along with this, and further you have server side proper validation and avoid only client side validation. This is the thing you need to do. Next, like insecure authorization. Like what happens is normal user, there is a difference between the normal user and admin user. So like if normal user can access admin privilege URLs, then it is not a good thing. So insecure direct IDR or basically refers to insecure direct object reference. So this kind of vulnerability can occur if you are properly not implemented access control over the application. So proper authorization checks should be implemented. And even when we log in, we get a cookie value. That is the cookie value that after we enter username and password at backend, we get a cookie value that authenticates us as a genuine user. After the means you enter proper username and password, then the cookie value is assigned. So this cookie value assigned should not be spoofed. Means someone should not able to guess or easily get that cookie value. So like if someone is setting a cookie value as IMEI number, so it is a like big problem because IMEI number of your device can be retrieved. So it is very incorrect or insecure way of implementing the cookies in application that will result to a big disaster. So that should be avoided. And further, privilege escalation, like I told, normal users should not be able to access page of a admin privilege. So that kind of access control need to be implemented. Even within the same users also, you need to implement proper privileges. So that there is nothing like improper controls or so. How to fix these issues? For this, we use JSON Web Tokens, JWT. That is JSON Web Tokens. That is a secure way of implementing tokens. And even you should get logged out of your application after inactivity. Like your token should expire, and you should get logged out if you are not using that application. If the access token is properly implemented, it will automatically expire after a certain interval, and if it is not accessed for certain time, so automatically application will log you out from that. So this kind of protections needs to be implemented, and access control should be defined properly at the developer end to avoid this kind of malicious things. Further, the client quality. While the application, Android application is developed, we need to ensure that the software development life cycle ensures secure coding practices at the initial end when the development has started. That at that point only we need to consider this kind of things. Further, storing sensitive data and string parameters. In strings, as I told, that it gets stored in form of DEX file. So DEX file can be converted to JAR, and then we can analyze that file. So if you find sensitive data inside the JAR Java code, then it is a not proper good practice. So you should avoid storing sensitive data in a source code. Personally, I found many times this kind of user information like Aadhaar card or some personal details being stored by users, developers in the application that can lead to very disaster. Further, how you can analyze that the code is secure or not? For that, we have tools like Find Bugs for Java that you can run over your code and get the analysis that what all things are wrong. And based on that, you can correct. Further, code tampering. Like what happens is, application, whenever we get an APK, it is signed by the organization. So whenever APK is distributed on a Play Store, before distributing on Play Store, it is signed by the developer certificate. So based on that, based on that, the code changes can be avoided. Like whenever you install, before installing, we need to check the developer certificate. If it is valid, then only we need to install. So this kind of checks you need to implement in your application. And even if someone resigns your application, like someone again tries to change the code and again develops a new APK, then it connects to your server along with the malicious URL in the background. That should be avoided. That kind of checks needs to be implemented. Yeah, signature check demo. I will show you a demo of this. Yeah, here I am using a tool called Key Tool. So this is the way we check the signature of the application. Yeah, key tool list jar file, and then the name of the APK. Yeah, see. So here we can see that we get the owner details. Like this is US. This is a normal application, so you can't get. If this is like some Facebook application, you can get the owner cert, CEO, CEO. All these details will be there. Issuer will be there. There will be some serial number, validity will be there based on that. So this all things you need to check using this command. And further, you can even use another tool called Jar Signer. This is the tool, Jar Signer. This also you can try as an activity. You can try assignment. Okay, fine. I will show next. We will move on with the further. Yeah. So, what happens is, if someone recompiles the APK and add a fake signature and redistributes the application, so your application should be developed in such a way that it should detect fake signature. So that kind of checks you need to implement in your Android application to provide any kind of tampering or malicious activity within the Android app. So that kind of checks can be done using the code checksum and integrity checks being implemented. Other than that, application, if it detects root detection, that also helps in fixing the vulnerability. Further, reverse engineering. Reverse engineering basically involves converting your DEX file to JAR file. So when I did APK tool decompile, we got a class dot DEX file. That DEX file we can analyze using converting it to JAR file. So there is another tool called JADEX and DEX to JAR, also DEX to JAR, that converts your DEX file to JAR file. That and that JAR file you can analyze using a tool called JADEX GUI, and that from that we can read the Java file source code, and we can analyze what the APK is doing. Further, even when we decompile APK, we even get .so files also. That also we can analyze using these tools like Gidra. So like library files depend on your mobile architecture. If your mobile is x86, library file x86 will work. So it depends on the mobile you are using and the whatever the configuration. So based on that, the library files will be loaded. So even HTTPS functionality. So attacker can see, sometimes what happens is some backdoors get remains that are being created as a testing functionality. But when you are setting up the production of in production, sometimes developers forget to remove the extra functionalities that are being enabled, and further it can lead to vulnerability if you have not removed them. So this kind of things need to be taken care when done. So further for auditing, this is the normal OWASP top 10. Other than that, what we can do is we can do penetration testing on mobile application, like the way we do in web application. For this, we have root detection checks and all. For bypassing all this, we need tools like Frida, Expose, etc. So you can try this. This is this bit penetration level. So I have covered the basic things. If any questions, let me know. Thank you.
Thank you, Danish.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Yeah, if any questions are there, I request participants to post in the group, WhatsApp group, so that Mr. Danish will answer. Now, end of the group. End of the presentation. Thank you very much for your participation.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.